And then this big, they call it identity or cultural crisis, which is reflected in the discussions and policies on migration, or on Islam. We've seen the catastrophe of Lampedusa.
Ah, later I want to talk about this.
But
heavy provocation, I warn you.
You said it as well. According to many, EU is bracing for the triumph of the right wing or extreme right wing forces in the next
Europe. Sorry to interrupt you, but I'm more of a pessimist here. Le Pen said a wonderful, terrifying thing when he explained one of his electoral losses, and he said, I lost because I won. That is to say, I lost because nonetheless my topic was accepted by the mainstream parties, you know.
Yes.
Like they said, okay, we don't want to do it in a barbaric way like Le Pen, but in a softer way they proclaim that Le Pen is addressing true problems, immigrants. My fear is that the right will win, extreme right, and we will not even notice it, because it will be part of the mainstream.
I share your opinion, and I want to ask you exactly, because you come from Croatia and Slovenia.
I know, from Europe and from Balkan.
And you mentioned Hungary.
Yeah.
You mentioned Greece. And somehow I have a feeling that these peripheral countries are more vulnerable to polarizations and to abuses in these identity debates, and we are witnessing it now with nationalist incidents in Croatia, with this fake referendum on gay marriages and so on, and we've seen this scenario unfolding already in Hungary, destroying Hungarian society, democratic institutions, and damaging the economy. And what is your view, and do you agree that these newcomers or peripheral countries are more vulnerable to these ideological and identity crises and manipulation?
I'll come back to several Slavoj's points, especially about the new movements and also the...
In Slovenia,
I will speak also about Croatia and other countries, but what is interesting, but I will come back to that, is also the line of demarcation, partisans on the one hand, and the Ustasha's fighters on the other hand. But what I'll start by a recent annual report by the European Commission. It was published, I think, 1 month ago. So they published a report on the enlargement and the neighboring countries of the European Union, namely six Balkan countries, including Iceland and Turkey. And you know why it's interesting? Because they name all the problems of all our countries. So you have Kosovo, the biggest problem in Kosovo is corruption. You have Serbia, the biggest problem of Serbia is, of course, corruption as well, but also the attitude toward sexual minorities. Then you have Turkey. The biggest problem, the European Commission says, of Turkey is police brutality on Taksim Square and the lack of democratization. And what my proposal is just to turn it around and to apply these measures of the European Commission to Europe itself. So, if we speak about corruption, why wouldn't we speak about Christian Wolf, who had to resign because of a corruption affair? Why wouldn't we speak about, and I'll come back right now to your question, why wouldn't we speak about Jacques Chirac? If we speak about police brutality at Taksim Square, why don't we speak about the Genoa protests? Why don't we could spend the whole night here naming all the police brutality at all the protests from Spain, Greece, Portugal, or even Croatia, and so on? But when you ask me, aren't the peripheral countries more vulnerable to right-wing extremism, if I understood it right, I would say, spontaneously, I would say yes. But if we look closer, I would say no. If we speak about the attitude towards sexual minorities in Serbia, then we must unfortunately mention that in France, in Paris, we had hundreds of thousands of people protesting against gay marriage. My country, Croatia, is now part of the European Union. So, you know, you have the European Commission criticizing Serbia because of their attitude towards sexual minorities, but you have a part of the European Union, that's my country, and I don't say it proudly, which in 3 or 4 days will have a referendum against gay marriages. So which, what they try to do is
probably they will win. The
opponent. They will win. That's important to add because there will probably come another referendum. What is important to say that in Croatia we had only two referendums. The first referendum, Slavoj remembers it very well, me not so much because I'm much younger, that was the referendum for independence after the collapse of Yugoslavia. The second referendum, and here is Croatia, the new record holder, it has only 43% of turnout, that was the referendum for the entrance to the European Union. So can you imagine, you had two very important referendums. The first was the referendum for independence. The second was the referendum for the entrance of the European Union. Now in my country we have a third referendum. It's a referendum against gay marriages. At the same week that the Croatian government has a new labor law and so on, you have austerity measures and so on and so on. And what will come now, and here I come back to something where we maybe finally, or we will just act like the Monty Python where we disagree, is that after the referendum against gay marriages, you will have probably a new referendum, and it's a referendum against Kyrillic. As you probably know, you
Kyrillic,
know,
you know
the Serbs, that's the letter of the Serbs, you know, it's not like our letter, but whatever. But also the Croatian letter, if you go back to history, used Kyrillic. And then you have, of course, the city of Vukovar, which was beside Dubrovnik and Sarajevo and Mostar and some other cities, the most destroyed city during the war. And what they're doing now is actually they want to change the constitution that only if a minority has more than 50%, they can have their letter. You can hear the paradox of it. If you have more than 50%, then you, of course, you're not the minority anymore. You're the majority. So what they're doing now is they're collecting signatures in Konzum, and that's one of the richest guys in Croatia whose surname is, incidentally, you're not Todorić. They're collecting signatures in the shopping malls. What they did for the referendum against gay marriages, they collected signatures in churches. So what you have in Croatia, and here I will slightly disagree, but in the end we will agree, I think, is that, you know, 2 years ago, I would be the first who would say, you know, nationalism and all this story is over, it won't happen again, and we have to focus ourselves on political economy. And now I would, of course, say, yes, we have to focus ourselves on political economy, but unfortunately, I think the 90s in ex-Yugoslavia are coming back. And we really have to put this line of demarcation between, not partisans, but between the left and between the right wing. And we cannot just focus on political economy. I think now in Croatia, it's getting worse than in Greece because it's illegal. Okay, the Golden Dawn is a big party and so on, but in Croatia, you will have two referendums, and I think it's a real right-wing turn. Second point about the movements. Yes, I completely agree with you when you say...
But I only talked about Slovenia.
Yes, but I also agree with this if you speak about Croatia. You know, before Slovenia, and I convinced you to support the protests because at one point of time they were really... really going somewhere. Just 1 year before Slovenia, we had huge protests in Croatia, with tens of thousands of people on the streets every 2 days and so on. What happened? We get rid of the conservative government, and now we got, as Slavoj said, an even more radical government when it comes to economy. But if we don't speak about Slovenia or Croatia, I would say on the first glance, the situation, we could quote, of course, Visconti or Lampedusa and say everything must change in order so everything can stay the same. Because, you know, in Tunisia, what you got after the Arab Spring, you, of course, got the killing of Chokri Belaid and the huge crisis. What you got in Egypt is the Muslim Brotherhood and the Arab Spring and so on. What you got in Slovenia is Janez Janša with a human face and so on and so on. But what I would detect here, and I'm asking you if you would agree, is actually that all these movements failed because of fear of power. You know, the Egyptian left failed because the Muslim Brotherhood on the terrain was much more successful, giving medical aid, social welfare to the poor people, and you know, all the left was fetishizing, in a way, direct democracy, and saying, okay, the elections will come, but we don't care about the elections, and you know, when the elections came, the Muslim Brotherhood came. I would say the same goes for the Occupy Wall Street, in a way, as well.
Can I just reply to this Croat Ustashi guy? Sorry. He's my good friend, and the only distinctive mark is that I all the time humiliate good friends. Sorry, quite seriously. No, I agree with you, but first... an interesting thing to know back to Egypt that you mentioned, no? But here I'm a little bit more optimist. I hope we also agree here that, you know, it's nonetheless too simple to say this is this liberal Western smug attitude. So what? Was it worth to rebel against Mubarak? It's now even worse. No, it's not as simple as that. What my Egyptian friends are telling me is that nonetheless the social texture change, let's call it naively, the civil society is alive. You have trade unions, women organizations, students and so on. You know, the social body is not the same. There is a third force which is neither Muslim Brotherhood nor the old corrupted Mubarak nomenclatura. Second thing, now comes the key point. What you said, I totally agree that this focusing of economy doesn't mean we simply leave those ideological struggles aside, but I will try to be as precise as possible. It's precisely if we just... This is the usual attitude of left liberal enlightened intelligentsia. You know, for them big problems are gay rights and so on, and they silently pass over economy. But what we have to see is that if we formulate the problem in this way, then a lot of workers' unrest of ordinary people is canalized precisely by this fundamentalist right. So my point is that if we, of course we should fight against fascism, blah blah, but if we do it just in this liberal, multicultural way, without connecting it to economic struggle.
You're completely
agree. Yeah. Then we end up in a situation, because again, this is my big obsession. This is, I think, the central catastrophe of the last decades of European American politics, of how the critical energy, which was the energy of left-wing popular protest, is now taken over mostly, with the exception of last year's protests, by, right, I mean, if you say today popular discontent, in United States at least, it's more often than not right-wing populist protest. And I was quite shocked when a friend convinced me that if you look in the United States at the conflict between state and civil society, where as a leftist I'm on 99%, I'm for the state there, you know, because it's usually civil society, usually means a small mobilization of right-wing tea parties. They want either some openly racist measures or whatever. So I think it's crucial, yes, I agree with you, gay marriage and so on, we should unconditionally insist on this. But we should nonetheless not forget about economy. We should have the two together, otherwise we will always remain this minority fighting for gay rights and so on, while the majority will do the scandalous things that you mentioned. We had the same shock already years ago in Slovenia, where there was a similar referendum, I think, if lesbian mothers should be allowed to get impregnated, blah blah blah, and we thought it's 50-50, and then the right wingers won like 75-25%. And so on. But again, I claim that it's not that naturally people are so conservative. It's more that the way ordinary people perceive the situation, that the mistrust of the situation is overtaken by this ideological mobilization. This seems to me pretty crucial. Now the provocation. When you mentioned Lampedusa and so on, I will say now something horrible. I want to accuse here what I see as a hypocrisy of the liberal left intelligentsia, who talk when you deal with immigrants as if, okay, they protest Italian measures. I claim it's hypocrisy. In the sense that they know very well that what is their implicit demand? It's never clear to me. For example, those who protest the Lampedusa deaths, what is their idea? That they should just treat more in a more human way those who try to immigrate, because if they don't, they want this, then this is nothing. Or do they want to simply open up the borders? Do they really mean it? I mean, because sometimes some radical leftists talk as if we should open up the borders. But are they afraid that this can lead to a catastrophe. And I'm not talking now as a potential right winger. I'm just saying that the typical leftist hypocrisy is to take a problem like immigrants and just let's open up the situation there, everyone can come, and then what? Nothing would be changed. It was,
I think they mean intervention in Africa.
Do they mean this? Well, that's my problem. I am all the time asking them this.
Raising the aid to the developed world, intervening directly, because now we know it's from Libya that these immigrants are coming. And directly, European intervention in Libya created chaos that now...
Yeah, but these people mostly are not from Libya, I think.
No, a lot of people are from Libya.
They are from Libya. I thought they come further down.
What I wanted to add, you know what François Fillon, when he was prime minister, did after the intervention in Libya?
What?
He sent two planes of medical aid to Libya, and you know, on the first glance, it's a wonderful gesture of solidarity.
Yeah.
You know what he said afterwards? We sent the medical aid in order to prevent the waves of new immigrants to Lampedusa.
Yeah, so of course.
What the Italian government did after the Arab Revolution, after Tunisia, they put navies around Lampedusa not to save immigrants, but actually to distract them. You know what they're claiming now?
Yeah.
I don't know if you saw that.
Yeah.
That they want to implement drones in the Mediterranean Sea.
Like to control where?
Drones controls, like not the drones with bombs, like in Pakistan.
Okay, but nonetheless, now I ask you. Okay, we know all these chorus. What would you have done?
In Lampedusa, I wouldn't give the Nobel Peace Prize. I completely agree with you. You know, there were some guys who were claiming we have to give the Nobel Peace Prize to Lampedusa. Did you know that? And that's exactly what you said, what you were criticizing the leftists who were claiming some sort of more humanist approach. In a way, you wouldn't agree here with me, I would open the borders.
I don't know.
No, why? Because I think, you know, the European project, Europe as such, was from the beginning founded on multi-ethnicity, multiculturalism, influences from other, and I'm not speaking now, as you probably know, like a multiculturalist, but it was founded on diversity, you know, and I don't know if you were in Italy, it was 2 years ago, in a small city called Lucca, they banned all authentic food. You know, they banned kebabs, falafel, and so on. Then in Milan, where you have, I don't know, 2,000 different restaurants and so on, they banned everything. And here, come to my thesis, then you had a famous Italian cook who said, but you know, there is no such thing as authentic Italian food. You know, the tomato sauce came from Peru, and our noodles came from Marco Polo, who got it from China. So in a way, you know, this openness of Europe, and I'm really not speaking as a naive multiculturalist, was actually the foundation of Europe. And when we speak, you know, about Franco Berardi, Biffo speaks about it, that the European continent is dying because of old people. Why don't you get younger people? Of course, we have the unemployment of young people in Europe as well. But you know, you could change the situation. So in a way, I would propose not completely opening the borders, but to rethink that.
You're already making the first step in the compact. Because you know what's the problem for me? Like, if we do what you say, okay, what I know this is pragmatic reasoning, but what would have probably happened is that the moment there would be rumors we can enter Europe, this would probably explode into a large exodus. And then what I fear is that an immediate, in an answer, explosion of right-wing populist parties opposing it.
But you have it anyway.
No, don't play with fate here. You have it anyway, but it can be much worse. You know, now you sound for me like those communists in 1933 who, they said, who cares about Hitler even before we had it anyway, bourgeois dictatorship. Yes, but there is a slight difference, you know. No, but really, what I mean is, and then what? Then we will have Western Europe and Africa will stay the way it is or whatever.
But okay, what would you do? I'm not Advocatus Diaboli. What would you do?
I would, the problem, first, I am a pessimist, as usual. I think that there simply is no simple solution here, but I would have been for what you mentioned, for some kind of coordinated, not so much aid, as even if violently imposed, for example. Because in Africa we have such mega tragedies. Look, a country that I always mention, like Congo. I mean, it's so rich in natural resources and so on. And people are starving and the state doesn't function and so on and so on. I mean, the first goal should be to make those states sustainable, I don't know how to somehow make them functional. Without that, but the, this is not to avoid a misunderstanding. I'm not saying primitive barbarian Africans, we should civilize them. I'm well aware that Congo, precisely the way it is now, a non-functioning state, it's fully integrated into world market precisely the way it is. Local warlords saying minerals for computers, you know, all the story and so on and so on. I'm just saying that, what I'm just saying is that how ambiguous these simple formulas are, for example, even with my very good friend Badiou, I had a small problem here, you know, his famous formula is against, for immigrants. Kiet ishi edisi. The one who is here is from here. Like, to reject this, you know, we are authentic inhabitants here. But you know what then my Israeli friend Udi Aloni told me? Oh, wonderful. Israelis, West Bank settlers would greet immensely this formula of Badiou. That's what they are saying on the West Bank. They come and say, we are here, so we are from here, and so on. You know, and then immediately you get caught into these problems. What immigration is allowed, what not, and so on, and so on. My problem here is, if I may just continue, is this one. When you mention this national identities, Europe and so on, I agree with you if this were, it was your implicit answer, that we shouldn't, I agree with you, but I would be afraid to just limit this phenomena to southern or even southeastern Europe. Look, let's look at what in our ideological everyday perception is the most noble of what Europe has socially, Scandinavian countries. Sorry to inform you, they have the same right-wing populism at its very violent. Remember Gert Wilders in Holland, remember what in Sweden, anti-immigrant violence and so on and so on. So I think unfortunately it's not just here. And where I am a pessimist is, okay, is that I don't, my fear is the following one. I claim that this is my pessimist vision. And I like to be a pessimist, you know why? Because pessimists are the only happy people. You expect the worst, and then usually things are not so absolutely bad, and so you are happy. You see, it's not so bad, you know. So, as a pessimist, I would have said that some people are too naive when they project the image of global capitalism as nonetheless Fukuyama, liberal, enlightened, and they see in this new anti-immigrant nationalisms and so on a kind of primitive obstacle to it. No, I think what is now slowly emerging, and this is what worries me, is a capitalism which economically can be extremely brutal, liberal, but at the same time with strong racist, ethnic identity, authoritarian state, and so on and so on. And what I fear is that this will gradually evolve here. But can we